Welcome to Discover Health, a White Mountain Perspective. Thank you for joining us today. I am your host, Dr. Tom Barela. Today we have a very special guest, Dr. Christina Sales, an internationally known expert in early childhood development. She's an author, she's a lecturer, and she also is a frequent visitor to the White Mountains. And we're delighted to have you join us today, Dr. Sales.
Thank you, Dr. Barela.
Okay. And I'm going to use my prerogative and short it to Christina because we have talked on numerous occasions before. So your expertise is in early childhood development, an incredibly important point for all of us as parents to make sure that our children grow up and learn correctly, if it can be said correctly. And so I think the important thing for us to understand before we get into the wonderful videos that you have is just how do children learn?
Well, I come from a Piagetian perspective, and I believe it because it makes so much sense to me. And what he says is that we are born with a desire, a need to have something he called equilibrium, or to be in a state of equilibrium. And by that, by equilibrium, he means a state where we are comfortable. Or one could think about it as us having all the knowledge we need to solve any of the problems that come across us or at that moment. So it's a place where we're happy and where we're content, where we're perfectly satisfied. That's equilibrium. However, life isn't like that much, not even for babies the minute they're born. They were in equilibrium in the womb, but they come out into this world of bright lights and it's cold, and immediately they're in something he calls disequilibrium. Disequilibrium being any time we're not in equilibrium.
Okay.
So, and immediately a baby tries to, because we have this desire, he or she tries to get back into equilibrium, just as we all do all the time. And so this baby's going to cry, and the mother will find some way to satisfy it. She'll feed it hold it close or keep it warm. We wrap them tight. And that's how it works all through life. We express our disequilibrium, and our desire to get back to equilibrium is very strong in all of us. And so it is between, the most important thing that I think we need to know is between disequilibrium and this need for equilibrium that learning takes place.
Okay.
So it is my job as an educator to find a place of disequilibrium that is not too far above anyone's ability to solve a problem. And for our young children, I need to develop activities that they're interested in, because if we're not interested in the problem that comes across our way, then we can get out of disequilibrium in several ways. We can decide we don't care about it. And if we truly don't care about it, we can get back to get back from disequilibrium to equilibrium by simply ignoring the problem.
So does that mean that learning is something that needs to be desired?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
That's why all of us as adults, when we want children to learn, we need to have activities that are interesting and something they care about. Because for instance, as we talk today, if you don't care what I'm talking about, or if someone I'm lecturing to doesn't care what I'm talking about, we as adults know how to pretend that we care. So we can nod and we can make eye contact, but if we're not interested, what I say is going right over our heads, and we could be thinking about the movie we're going to go to tonight or anything else. So caring and interest are basic to learning, to true learning.
Is that innate in young children?
Yes, I think it is. I think it's innate in all of us.
It wasn't for me when I was in school. I wasn't innate, but it seems like...
Maybe it wasn't innate because what you were supposed to be learning wasn't of interest and you didn't care about it.
Right, but in young children, aren't they like sponges for education and learning?
Yes, I think they are, except when we turn them off.
Okay.
And oftentimes, and that's my heartbreak, is that so many times we set up our classrooms to do things that are not interesting to children or that are beyond what they already know, that we haven't given them the foundational information that they need to know to be successful. And so they turn off and they drop out of school intellectually and emotionally when they're very young. So it's really important that we need to engage children in interesting activities that they care about, so that they will want to learn. And so that's my job.
Okay.
To develop activities that will have within them the things that we as a society have decided we all need to know. And you have to do that in small, I mean, there's geometry activities, there's physics activities, there's
speech.
Dressing.
Cleaning.
Yes, all of those activities, yes. There's all those activities that they need to learn. But when a mother teaches the child, her baby, the word shoe, for instance, she doesn't say, this is a shoe. Say shoe.
Okay.
All right, I'm going to show it to you again. Say shoe. She says instead, let's go find your shoes. You have to put your shoes on before we go outside.
Okay.
So that's a natural, interesting way for children to learn. Instead of saying shoe, say shoe.
Okay.
All right. Anyway, so...
So you have activities.
I do.
Brought some activities with you today.
I did. One of the things I want to talk about first, before we talk about the activity, is for young children, say between 3 and 5, they think much differently than older children and adults. And what they see the world, they understand the world through what they observe around them. We call that understanding the world through their perspective or through
someone else's eyes, a very common.
Yes, or through just, what I'm trying to explain is that they do not think at the logical level that adults do.
Okay.
And I've got a demonstration here that
okay.
I think will help us understand that.
Okay.
That these are called pattern blocks, and they're something I've been using with young children for a long time. And they're something parents could find. They're fairly inexpensive.
Okay.
But it's easy. These blocks are geometry blocks, and they relate to each other. For instance, one blue diamond or rhombus is the same as two triangles. And we can see that because we can put it right on top and we can see that that's true. So they can make the same shape and they take up the same area, right? So then it turns out that three of these you can put together to make a hexagon. So, all right? So three of those make a hexagon. And these are called trapezoids, and two trapezoids are the same as a hexagon. And six triangles, well, first we can show this. Three triangles make a trapezoid, so it makes perfect sense that six trapezoid would make a hexagon.
Yes.
So
okay.
It's pretty easy, and young children can see easily that these all can make the same shape and all have the same
but
area.
But don't they have to learn that?
They do. But,
how
and
do they
learn
it
by experimenting with it.
And they
go through a process that we call error-informed experimentation.
Okay. So let's start. Why don't you demonstrate what you're talking about?
Okay. So That's easy for children to understand. However, this relationship is not easy to understand. It doesn't, because these look nothing alike, the square and this narrow diamond look nothing alike. Young children don't understand that there's a relationship. But if we do this and make a little house out of both of them, and put a triangle in here, you can see that if we take the triangle away from both of them, these have the same area if you remove. So adults can understand that because that's a logical deduction, but children can't yet understand this kind of thing. So that's the difference in how young children think and older children think. And we use these with young children to help them learn geometry. And I have two videos here that we can look at to see how Noah starts out when he is first using these. And you can see here that he is using a puzzle, and he's using these blocks, and he is not...
Those are the diamond blocks.
These are the diamond blocks. And he's trying very hard to put them in, and he tries over and over again, but they won't fit because the angles are wrong. So no matter how hard he tries, they're not going to work. And you can see that he doesn't know that yet. He has to experiment and try over and over again to do this.
Okay.
And when he's tried lots of times and it doesn't work, as you will see, he just gives up. However, in the second video, he has worked for a long time. And now here he is at the top of the video right here. And you can see now that he's learned about the angles that this same design requires. And you can see the confidence he now has in everything he picks up.
He's just kind of putting them right in the areas of the puzzle quickly.
That's right. It's because he now has learned about area and space and angles and what the design requires him to put in. And he's no longer just putting in what he wants to put in. He's putting in what he knows will work.
And how long did it take him to learn this?
It took him about 4 weeks.
4 weeks?
Mm-hmm.
And how many times was he exposed to it during the sport?
He was exposed to them for 7 different times.
Episodes.
Yeah.
So it took him seven episodes.
Yeah.
Sounds better than 4 weeks.
Yes, that's true. It does. But he had to think about it in between those times. That's why I mentioned the 4 weeks, because it takes time to think about it and figure it out. He had to really think.
So, and this is how a lot of children develop thought processes.
Yes.
I draw the inference of kids who put a couple chairs together to get on the countertop to get into the cookie jar.
Exactly.
Where they actually have to plan and think. And it isn't, they don't do it always the first time.
No. Like I said, we call that error-informed experimentation. You try one thing and it doesn't work, and then you figure it out, and then
the aha is there for both the child and the parent, because the cookie jar is now empty.
Right. Another good activity is cooking at home. And you learn these same kinds of things through cooking with children. And I also have another activity that we do in the classroom called Ramps and Pathways.
Okay, so let's, and do you want to, I know you have a video for Ramps and Pathways. Do you want to give us kind of an introduction of what we're going to see in the videos?
This is cove molding that you use between the ceiling and the wall in a house. And it's simple cove molding cut into 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 foot pieces. And we use this to make ramps. And the first thing we do is we put it down and we ask children, we put some kind of sphere, depending on the age of the child, so that they don't swallow it. A sphere, and I might ask them, how can you get it to move from here to here or from here to here? And sometimes they'll use their finger and push it, and sometimes they'll blow it, and eventually they figure out to lift one end in some way. And I have a couple of videos to show you, particularly about slope, that I think will help demonstrate this experimentation that children must go through to figure this out.
A little bit different of a thought process.
Yes, this is
more
physics.
Science. More
yes.
science.
Yes, this is
than,
physics.
Than perception.
Right. Yes. And what they're learning here is gravity and speed and about incline and distance.
I think these videos will be very interesting to see how the children solve these particular problems.
Okay.
So let's go on and do it.
All right.
When teachers allow children the freedom to try out their own ideas, children soon become interested in setting problems for themselves. The child in the circle attempts to build a ramp that empties into a container. As you watch him, you will see the process of the construction of knowledge. At this point, he has not yet constructed the relationship between the slope of the ramp and the direction the ball will roll. Although he expects the ball to roll toward the container, it continues to roll down the slope toward the sponges. He appears to think that there is something about the highlighted end that causes the ball to roll toward it. Unaware of the slope, he turns the ramp around as if this will cause the ball to roll into the container. The process of experimentation continues as he adds a sponge to the support and tries again. Observing the ball still rolling away from the container, he varies his action again by adding more sponges to the support, thereby changing the slope. Once again, he places the ball on the ramp and finally succeeds. Had the teacher solved the problem for him, it would have robbed him of this aha moment. He is making progress in constructing the relationship between the slope of the ramp and the direction the ball rolls. Children create highly complex structures only after long experiences constructing relationships about slopes, supports, connections, and other elements of pathway design. When this child was challenged to create a structure within a taped-off area on the rug, she drew upon her prior knowledge of all of these relationships. She used this knowledge to take into account the need for each corner to drop so that the marble would continue downward on the spiraling pathway. She coordinated many relationships and was able to think about the system as a whole. Constructivist teachers allow children to try out their ideas.
Children try things because they believe they will work. If we tell them that they won't work, they will begin not to trust their own reasoning. She has constructed a misconception that when the marble rolls down off the ramp, that it will drop straight down. If we tell her she's wrong, she will lose confidence in herself and she will learn not to trust her own ideas. It's the teacher's job to set up the environment so that she will learn from the materials that her ideas won't work, not from another person. The children are working at cross purposes. He has constructed the relationship that it will go down an arc, and so he continues to put the basket out where he thinks it will catch. She, on the other hand, is constructing different relationships because she continues to put it very close to the bottom for it to drop straight down.
Where you think it'll go so they'll fall in from there?
They need to try out their ideas
so that their internal beliefs about what will work and what will not work will change. They can't do that without the experimentation.
Wow, that was really interesting. What did we just see?
Well, first of all, you notice how engaged the children were in what they were doing. And as the little boy was experimenting with the ramp, which was like this to begin with, he was producing something. He was putting the marble here and having it move. And then he was observing, because the result of what he was doing was immediate, he was able to see the reaction of his action. And so he kept doing that and doing that and doing that, and he was able to make a judgment about what he should do next by thinking about what he saw happen as a result of his actions.
And putting more blocks underneath.
Yes, and so eventually he put more and more blocks underneath until he was successful. So he was, and at the same time he was learning what happened with incline and distance and slope and all kinds of other physics laws that we have.
Well, let's talk about the second one, because there's two children in that with completely different thought processes.
Yes, there certainly are.
So why don't you talk about that?
All right. The little girl thought that the arc, she did not understand that speed makes an arc when mm-hmm. things go. So she was putting the basket close, and he was pulling it back and forth. So they were having a struggle between them. But in a very, in an instant there, the little boy puts a marble at the very end of the ramp, and she sees it drop. And when she sees that, the next time she puts her marble at the end to see it drop. And so she learned from his actions what would happen. And then if you notice, she went up back further and further and further to see what would happen every time she dropped it in. So again, she's learning about the laws of physics in the world, doing something that she wanted to do, going where I wanted her to go.
But it's interesting, she was younger than the boy.
Actually, they were pretty close at the same age. They were just at two different developmental levels or understanding.
Well, it was interesting to see the boy recognize the arc at the end of the and tried to correct her. And this is all part of the learning process.
It is. You know, I was just sitting there watching this and encouraging them to think about it and to struggle with the problem and to interact as they did that. And so they were learning from each other the things we need them to learn.
And they were doing it themselves, which is a really big piece of this information.
Yes, that's the whole point, that we create activities where children can do something. They can observe what they see. What they do is immediate, so they can vary what they do, so they can figure out solutions to the problems that we set for them. And parents can do this at home, to think about those kinds of things, to set up those kinds of activities for their children. Cooking is extremely important. We have at the Regents Center for Early Developmental Education, where I retired from, they have a website that has all kinds of free recipes that you can download and games and all kinds of things that are this kind of activity that parents and teachers, educators can get for free by just going to the website and downloading all of those activities.
So I like the cooking, because a lot of parents, especially in a fast food environment, aren't adept at cooking much anyway, but getting your child in. But children really enjoy decorating cookies or dyeing Easter eggs.
Or making a shake. Or cooking a muffin or making a pancake.
All of those things, even a funny face on a pancake.
Yes, yes.
And so those are all wonderful, wonderful activities for the children. Now we have a few minutes here. Are there any other topics that you'd like to discuss along with this today?
Games are a really wonderful way to teach children mathematics. Like, for instance, if you use a board game, one thing that a child does, if you have a board game out for young children, when you throw a dice and you're sitting here, you need to move. Say you need to move three spaces. You go 1, 2, 3. But lots of young children go one, two, three. And this is an adding on problem. Like if you have three and five, if you have five, you need to count one, two, three to add to eight. You don't count five, the fifth one again. So when you throw a die, what I do is I take an empty die and I put lots of ones on them so that when children play a game and they get a roll that says one, it no longer makes sense for them to count the one they're on because you're supposed to move ahead.
Oh, interesting.
So they figure out that, oh, wait, one. No, that doesn't work. One means this. And so that's a way for children to figure out by themselves what to do instead of just telling them. Because when you tell them and they think this is right, that's what their reasoning is. And when we're always telling them the answer, that makes them think that they're wrong and they learn not to trust their own reasoning. But when they're in a situation where it doesn't make sense to them, then they change their thinking and think in a new and more complex way, which is exactly what we're striving to get them to do.
Well, I know as an early childhood educator, your forte in life is teaching educators to give children these techniques to make learning.
Children need activities that challenge them, not that they can already do. If you can already do, there's nothing exciting or interesting to learn to do. There has to be a challenge within it to make you want to do it.
And that means that learning needs to be fun. And we're out of time today. And Dr. Sales, I'd really like to thank you for coming up, number one, to the White Mountains, and number two, taking time out of your leisure to spend with us to teach us how early childhood learning is important for children's development. Thank you.